Praise God. Everybody okay this morning?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter 8. So, always so good to have brother and sister Pinella with us. Would you just welcome them. These are good people. Brother Pinella is my former presbyter for a short time when I was with the Christian Church in North America, the Italian band. We see them in the book of Acts. Praise God. Romans chapter 8. I'm going to read verses 18 through 25. Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Rome, he says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope, for what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it." The title of my message this morning is, "How Long?" How long? God's word is infinite. It is eternal. It is fathomless. It is boundless. And we could not exhaust the learning of the word of God in 1,000 lifetimes. And yet I'm often drawn back to the same passages of scripture. Are you like that? Does that happen to you? I'm sure it does. We all have our favorite passages of scripture, a verse or verses perhaps may have changed your life. You read it, it spoke to you, maybe it was a sermon you heard, and that passage of scripture was one that it just gave birth in your heart, and you go back to that place for security, for comfort, for encouragement. The Psalms are like that. They give us encouragement and strength. Perhaps it's verses that remind us of his promises, like Paul writing to Titus when he talks about the blessed hope. Maybe we go back to those and review the scriptures regarding the blessed hope, the coming and the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. I find comfort in reviewing passages that remind me of the temporality of the existence here on planet Earth. The things that remind me that this is not forever here, that this life one day will be over and there's so much more. Some days you wake up in the morning and you're so excited to face the day, right? There's good things ahead. You've got plans. You've got dreams. You have hopes. You wake up. You're excited. You can't wait to get going. Other mornings, not so much. And we find this expression, "How long?" We find that in the Bible many times, many times. Going back to the book of Genesis, we see this phrase, "How long?" God asks of his people, "How long will they refuse to keep my commandments? How long will this people provoke me?" Job asks this question, "How long will thou speak these things?" He's talking to his friends that have come to encourage him or whatever it is they were doing. You know, how long are you going to bend my ear with your philosophy? How long do I have to endure my friends? And then the prophets ask this question, "How long, Lord, before all these things happen?" the things that they were in fact prophesying. God so told them to speak about the things to come, but they didn't know when. So even the prophets asked, Lord, how long? And then 19 times in the Psalms, 4 times in Psalm 13 alone, we find this phrase, how long? David says, how long wilt thou forget me, O Lord, forever? How long wilt thou hide thy face from me? The question, how long, presumes an ending. You with me? How long? The question, it assumes or presumes that there is an ending in this. How long? Until. How long, perhaps, until the end comes, or how long until something changes? The question, how long, presumes that there's something coming, an end or a change or something else. I find myself asking this question of the Lord all the time these days. How long, Lord, before something changes in my life? How long, Lord, before we see a move of your Holy Spirit in your church? How long, Lord, before we see a stirring of the hearts of your people? Or how long, Lord, before you come to take us to the Father's house, that place that you have prepared for us? How long? Last week, I talked about a comparison, remember? Comparison. I talked about how in doubting our salvation, we are comparing our sin, as vulgar and disgusting as it is, but we are comparing our sin to the infinite mercy and matchless grace of Almighty God. When we say, oh, I think my sin is keeping me from being saved, and I don't know if God really loves me, and I don't know if this is all going to work out for me, we're comparing our sin to the matchless mercy and grace of God. Remember I said that? In every aspect of existence between us and God, there is no comparison. And Paul said in our text this morning, he said, in our present dilemma, there is no comparison to what God has in store for us. Listen, I've said many times that not one single family or not one single individual that I'm aware of that is not suffering something, some trial, some difficulty, some burden, some pressure. Listen, the word suffering in this text is the same word translated afflictions elsewhere in Scripture. So when we see sufferings or afflictions, it's basically the same word, suffering, afflictions. And I know of no one, no single family or person who's not suffering one affliction or another. Are you still with me?
Amen.
Life used to be so simple, or so it seemed. Now, even the difficulties that we had in times past just didn't seem as difficult as they are today, right? Even our difficulties didn't seem as difficult. I love watching TV. I love watching old TV. I love watching black and white TV. I'm grateful. We kicked cable to the curb. And we stream our television now, and I'm really grateful for that, because you could watch anything you want. And on some of the services that we stream, there's the marathons, like, you know, all Gilligan's Island all day long, or Leave It to Beaver all day, or we've got 3 Cineview channels where we watch all the old movies, the black and white and the early movies, and I could sit and watch those television shows all day long. Now, lest you question my sanity, I don't watch them for their intellectual content. You with me on that? I don't watch Gilligan for the intellect, nor do I watch them for the storyline. Because let's face it, Gilligan is going to be, it's going to be the same ridiculous plot every single time you watch it. But I watch those shows not for intellectual connection or to study the storyline, but I watch those for the feeling. You with me? The emotion that it triggers. When I sit there watching a black and white Leave It to Beaver, it takes me back to little Marky Mapo, little boy Marky, sitting in the living room, you know, watching the black and white television with the rabbit ear antennas and the matchbook folded up behind the dial to keep it on the right channel. Come on, you remember that, right? Those old channel knobs would wear out in the... For you young people, the matchbook would keep it in place. Otherwise, you would just get, you know, gray stuff across the screen. But I, you know, and I'm sitting there watching these shows, and I'm thinking about my bicycle outside with the banana seat in the you know, the wheelie bar. And it puts me back to a place, to a time when life was just so much simpler. Most families had only one job. Now, listen, I don't mean to oversimplify things, but basically one job was enough for the household. It covered the expenses, and mom got to stay home and raise the kids. Oh, no, not that. These days, that's like, you know, that's offensive. No, it was really good that mom could stay home and raise the kids if she wanted to. If not, she can go to work. All's well. Yeah. But life was simpler, and most families only had one car in the household. That's a whole lot less gasoline, a lot less insurance, a lot less car repairs. There's a lot less aggravation having only one car in the family. Now, and I say that because nowadays, you know, every person in the house has a car. And if there's four people in the house, you know, here's the thing. It affects the traffic. Now you got four times the cars on the road, and more people on the in the population, and so the driving on the road is like being in the war zone. I used to love to drive. I used to drive for a living. I'd love to drive. Now, no. You're taking your life in your hands when you get out there on the road, and. Are you still with me?
Amen.
They used to roll up the sidewalk at 5 p.m. in most towns. Everything closed. A restaurant was open. You know, the movie theater. The mall. You know, when they came into existence. But for the most part, everything closed at 5 o'clock, and people went home and they enjoyed their families in their, you know, in their own little home. And so things were much easier then, much, much simpler then. At weekends, you know, weekends, everything shut down. You make sure you got your gas in your car on Saturday, because Sunday, there's nothing open on Sunday. Yeah. People went to church, they enjoyed picnics, they went to ball games, and they enjoyed their family time. Now listen, I realize that's not true for everyone. I mean, my mother worked 6 days a week to raise four kids on her own, and I know that some of you didn't, it wasn't exactly that simple, but it was certainly more simple than it is today. And all I mean to say is that things have certainly changed. They seem to have gone out of control. Paul says that all creation groaneth. Stir up any bad feelings, but we found a bunny dead in our backyard today, last week, and it seems we're finding mice, you know, because there's some feral cats that live in our neighborhood and they frequent our establishment. And we love kittens. We love cats. We love cats, right? They're beautiful, fluffy, furry little things. Not so good for the bunnies or for the mice, right? And then if you have cats in the neighborhood, you have foxes. Because foxes are looking for the cats. And if you have foxes, then you more than likely have coyotes, because the coyotes like foxes. And in certain places, if you have coyotes, you have wolves, because the wolves will chase down the coyotes. And if you have wolves, then you have bear, because the bear will hunt down. It's the food chain. And we're trapped in this vicious cycle of literally dog eat dog. And so all of creation is groaning. You know, we have earthquakes around the world. The frequency and the severity of earthquakes, just as Jesus said, would come in the last days as a sign. The earthquakes around the world. Literally, the earth is trembling. You got volcanoes erupting all over the planet. Volcanoes. Because there's such great pressure. The earth is under such incredible pressure that it's spewing every chance it gets. Tornadoes have been blowing through like no one's business. Tornadoes that just blow lives away, towns away, homes, everything precious just blows them away. And hurricane season is almost upon us, and we have no idea what that's going to bring in. Listen, I'm just trying to say that all creation groans. Now that word groan is associated with grief or grieving. It expresses a deep emotion that can't find words. Have you ever been so oppressed, so depressed, so pressed that you just can't find words for how you feel? The pressure, the emotions are just so great that you can't, there's no words to speak. And the only thing that you can do is groan. It's about all that comes out. And if you are able to find words to express, generally the only words you can formulate are these: how long, Lord? How long? How long? Friends, there's no comparison. Paul says here in our text that there is no comparison. He said, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present world, this present time, are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. No comparison. Last week I said no match. This week, no comparison. Listen, Paul said that he reckoned. He said, I reckon. You with me?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I lived in Louisiana for 3 years when I went to Bible college down there. And I heard this term all the time, pretty much every day. I reckon. I reckon. Now just so you understand, just in case you don't speak Southern, I reckon down south generally means I'm not sure. I think so, perhaps, possibly, maybe, but I'm not quite sure. So I guess. That's not the way you listen. Paul didn't speak Southern. He didn't speak English. All right, so this word that's translated from the Greek into English, Old English, reckon, doesn't mean I guess. I think so. No, this word, as Paul used it, it's used in a numerical calculation. You with me? It's used often in a numerical calculation. In other words, Paul said, I have calculated all of the facts, and I have concluded. It's not I reckon, but it's a reckoning. You know, like when you reconcile an account. You take the facts and your debits and the credits, and you come to the bottom line, and you calculate, and then you conclude. Paul is saying, listen, Romans, I have concluded. After viewing all of the facts, after having all of the data presented to me, I have calculated and I have concluded that none of these afflictions, none of this suffering that we're dealing with here on earth is anything. It's not worthy to be compared to the glory that God has in store for us. No comparison whatsoever. I was listening to Dr. Bob Cook the other morning while I was driving in the war zone. Dr. Cook, you know, Bob Cook, Dr. Bob Cook, Walk with the King, you know that? How in the World Are You? Right? And he was comparing mental ascent to biblical faith, as I've often done. We've talked about that. mental assent compared to biblical faith. Now, mental assent is accepting God's word as true. You know, who here doesn't believe Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Who here doesn't believe John 3:16? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, right? I don't think there's anybody here who would say, well, I disagree with that. No, the word of God, we accept it. It's true. That's mental assent. I believe God's word is true. Every bit of it, I just believe it's true. Mental assent. But biblical faith is when that truth goes from our head into our hearts. When I know these things are true is mental assent, but now I have applied these truths to my life, and now I walk accordingly. I live according. My life has changed according to these things that I hold to be true. It's not just I believe these things. No, I believe them, and I have applied them, and they have affected change in my life. I've been changed because of these truths, and now I live by these truths. Are you with me?
Amen.
That's biblical faith compared to mental assent. Not only accepting as true, but acting upon them. Paul was not giving mental assent. He had revelation from the Holy Spirit. Paul had all the facts. And he knew what suffering was. Listen, if you want to read about Paul's suffering, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 16 through 33, read it on your own. But Paul talks about his afflictions. He talks about his sufferings. How many times he was beaten, whipped, caned, flogged, all of the above. He was in shipwreck several times. He was left for dead. He was arrested. He was in perils, of all manner of perils. Paul had been through the ringer. He'd seen it all. You want to talk about suffering? But he had also known the presence and the promises of God. So he didn't just reckon, like a southern term, but he calculated and concluded as fact that there is indeed no comparison. All the sufferings of this world that he endured, and all the sufferings of this world that we endure, and compared to what God has in store, he said, there is absolutely no comparison. Now remember, Paul's the guy who was caught up into paradise. He was caught up into the third heaven, into the dwelling place of God. Paul saw things and heard things that were so incredible. But he was not allowed to speak them or write them or share them. He had seen heaven. So he had all the facts. He had the suffering of this world, and he had the very presence of Almighty God to compare to. You with me? And so his reckoning, his calculation, his concluding, he said, there is absolutely no comparison. The prophets give us some insight as to the things to look forward to. Isaiah, Ezekiel, and others. Just Isaiah, for instance, chapter 11, verses 6 through 8, New King James, because it's easier. Isaiah says of the times to come, he said, the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat. So much for the food chain, right? And then he says, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. Isaiah said there's coming a time when a suckling child, a baby infant, will play with snakes, and they won't. There's nothing to worry about. A time of complete and absolute peace. And Isaiah 65, verses 7 and 18, For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing, and her people a joy. Friends, Jerusalem is anything but rejoicing today. The Bible says, even Ezekiel says, that it will be a boiling pot, boiling over. And that's pretty much what Jerusalem is today. That's pretty much what Israel is today, a boiling, a cauldron boiling over. It pretty much represents what the world is today. But both Isaiah and Ezekiel and others speak of a time when there will be rejoicing in Jerusalem, and her people will experience great joy. Listen, Paul talks here about the earnest expectation. So all of creation groans. And then he talks about the earnest expectation of the creature, the creation, that waiteth for the manifestation, the fullness, the full revelation of the sons of God. What we will be, what we will have. All creation just waits in eager expectation. Now, earnest expectation. We long for the good old days. Don't you?
Yes.
Like I said, I could sit and watch Gilligan's Island. Father Knows Best. Dobie Gillis. Carol Burnett. You could watch all those all day long. Because it takes me back to the good old days. Or whatever your good old days. Maybe it's Ozzy and Harriet. Whatever your good old days are. We would all like to return to gas under $2 a gallon and, you know, affordable groceries and peace and prosperity and, you know. My good old days include gasoline under 50 cents a gallon. And milk, 50 cents a gallon. My mother would send me down to the gas station, to the milk machine, with two quarters to get a gallon of milk. Let me just sidetrack to let you know what a rascal I was. If you put the 50 cents in the machine, and as it fell, as you heard it fall, if you hit the coin return right at the right time, you got the milk and the 50 cents. I don't know how I know that. I owe Guida's Dairy a lot of money, I'll just say. But we long for those, you know, back to our childhood, back to a simpler time of life. But Paul says that the future glory we are looking forward to is linked with the return of Christ and the glorious resurrection body that awaits us. The assumption here is that the new creation that Christ brings will restore lost paradise. Christ is going to come and restore what paradise lost, a new heaven, a new earth. All the things that Eden was, the earth will be again. That's the revised, the new kingdom of God, the new earth that Jesus is going to bring us. Are you still with me?
Amen.
You want to talk about the good old days, returning back to when things were better. We're going to be returned to when things were perfect. All of creation has been groaning for that day since Adam's sin brought the divine curse on planet Earth. But we're looking forward to God fixing everything. Paul said there's an earnest expectation. In Greek, that's one very long compound word, earnest expectation. Greek is like that, a bunch of words together to make one word. So we won't deal with the word, but it means earnest expectation. It means a strained expectancy, an eager longing. Literally, the stretching forth of the head. Have you ever been there? I know I've shared this analogy, this picture with you, but you've been there, you've been at the train tracks waiting for a loved one to come, right? Or you're wherever you are, you're waiting for the car to pull around the corner, and you're out there. You're out there in the front, and you're straining. You can't stick your head out any further. like a snapping turtle. You know, you're out there, you're straining. You want to see the very second you can see your loved one coming, or whatever that expectation is. That's this word. Paul talks about an earnest expectation, an eager expectation, a straining of the neck to see what's coming. We're waiting with eager anticipation and expectation. The emphasis here is on being the expectation. See, expectation is not a wish or a dream or an unfounded hope. I hope it all works out. I hope Jesus comes. I hope he fixes everything. I have dreams about good things happening. No, that's not at all what this means. Listen, it is this earnest expectation is a certainty. It is a guarantee. We are talking about a guarantee of things to come. Amen. Paul says, and we have already received the first fruits. The first fruits. It's one thing to hope for something completely unknown, right? You hope, I don't know what I'm hoping for. I hope everything, you know. But when you know, when you have tasted, when you have experienced, even just a little bit, I know this is a weak analogy. It's a very weak analogy, but go with me, all right? You know, if somebody says, okay, dinner, we're going to be eating soon. You're hungry, and, it's almost dinner time. And you get excited. Okay, I'm going to eat. I have no idea. What's for dinner? I don't know. You don't know, but okay, well, I'm going to eat, and so I'm excited. I have some expectancy. I hope it's good. But I don't really. But what if somebody said, okay, you're hungry? Your favorite meal is being prepared by your favorite cook. In your favorite environment, wherever that might be, your favorite restaurant, maybe it's outdoors, and your favorite meal cooked by your favorite chef in your favorite environment, and you could say, oh man, I can taste it. I can taste it already. I know what I'm getting, right? I have tasted and I know what I'm getting. Now, the anticipation, the expectation, it's not a wish, it's not a dream. I know what I'm getting and I can't wait to get it. Friends, we have tasted of the Lord. He has given us the first fruits of all that awaits us. It's just a taste, but it's a real taste. The fullness of the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, is a foretaste of glory divine. Amen? Are you with me? We've been given a taste of what awaits us. We've received the first fruits of His Spirit. Just a taste, but it is a real taste of all that awaits us. Paul is writing about the sustaining power of the gospel in the midst of the trials of life. Listen, he said, there's our affliction, our suffering is nothing. It's not worthy to be compared to all the glory that awaits us, to all that God has in store. He doesn't tell us that it's going to all go away. He's telling us until then, in the midst of all of this, we have the taste of heaven. We have the foretaste of glory. We have the first fruits of what awaits us in eternity. Paul's writing about the sustaining power of the gospel in the midst of the trials of life. Elsewhere, he refers to the earnest of our inheritance. An earnest is a guarantee. You know, if you're going to buy a home, you put down earnest money, right? You make a deposit. You put in an offering and you give your deposit. And then you go home and you call everybody and say, I just bought a house. Well, did you? Do you own the house? Did you pay for the whole thing? No. But you put earnest money. You put real money. It's a portion of the whole. And you gave it to them. And now they have a guarantee that you're going to go ahead and buy that home. You with me? It's real. It's a portion of the whole, but it's not just a dream. It's not just a wish. It's a certainty. It is a guarantee. Just a taste, but a promise of the entirety. And God has placed a deposit within us, a guarantee of the full purchase price. Now, friends, that purchase has been made, but the delivery date is scheduled for some time in the future. Like, you know, the cable company that says we'll be there between 8 and 12. What time? Somewhere.
Between.
I'm giving you indications, right? I'm giving you something to watch for. I'm telling you, you know, relatively when, but you don't know exactly when. Well, listen, the fullness, the fruition of all that God has in store for us, he's given us signs. He told us what to watch for. We don't know exactly when, but we can be excited about it because we know it's coming closer. Amen?
Amen.
Until then, we enjoy the first fruits as we await the completion. Listen, the kingdom of God is not like a bank CD. God's promises don't mature in 90 days. We don't know when, but we're told that we have the first fruits of the Spirit, and so we are to be filled with the Spirit, with his deposit, with his guarantee, with his first fruits, until he comes for us. He'll sustain us until he comes to take us to the Father's house. I'm closing. So how long? How long? We don't know. How long do we have to deal with all this aggravation? How long do we have to deal with our illnesses? How long do we have to deal with our pain? How long do we have to deal with all of the nonsense happening in the world, with the sin-sick world? How long do we have to deal with the, you know, with the earthquakes and the volcanoes and the traffic? And how long? I don't know. But we've been given signs to look for. And according to all that we can see and discern, it can't be much longer, friends. Are you with me on that?
Amen.
It can't be much longer. But we still have his promises. We still have the promises of his presence, of his protection, and of his provisions and peace until he comes. We still have the first fruits of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we need. And that's what we need to do. We need to enjoy his Spirit. Friends, you have all of eternity in your heart and in your life right now. You have all the glory of heaven. It's not the fullness, but you have a real taste of what God has in store for you. So we need to be filled with his Spirit, and we need to enjoy his Spirit, right? And we need to walk according to his Spirit. We can't just reckon. We can't just give it mental assent and say, oh, that's all good. That's all nice. And I believe all that. We must have a reckoning, a calculation, and a conclusion in light of all of God's word, in light of all of what the word of God has told us, in light of the fact that we have the first fruits of eternity dwelling within our hearts. We can conclude, as Paul did, that none of this light affliction that is but for a season, none of the trials that we face, none of the difficulties is near worthy to be compared with all that God has in store for us. Amen?
Amen.
And so we can live according to that. We can live by that. We can be encouraged by that and strengthened by that. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, God, for your promise. I thank you, Lord, that Paul has given us this clear message that nothing, Lord, he didn't minimize the trials of life. He simply said, in comparison, they're nothing. In comparison to the glory that awaits us. In comparison, Lord, even to the first fruits of the Spirit of God that we have now. Our trials, Lord, are not to be compared. I pray, Lord, that each one of us would embrace this truth. Lord, we'll go beyond mental assent, beyond just, I believe these things to be true. Lord, that we will apply them and live by them. Father, I pray, God, that if there's anyone here that has not been filled with your Spirit, that they would desire to be filled to overflowing. God, that's a gift from heaven. But Lord, we have accepted Christ, and so your Spirit dwells within us, and we have a foretaste. We have the first fruits of glory divine. I ask, God, that you would encourage my brethren this morning, Lord, that when we face this world, and even when we go out of here today, We won't look at the trials as being overwhelming, but Lord, we will remember that we have the Spirit of the living God. We have received the glory that is ours. I pray, oh Lord, that you would encourage us and strengthen us, and that you would be glorified in these things. And we ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm going to sing as we go. Don't be scared. Oh, faithful glory, Cynthia. I think she's faithful enough to. I think.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts me are hurled. For faith has caught a joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand.
Praise the Spirit and understanding, oh magnify your God. Put on the song, praise the Let's magnify the Lord this morning. God of all creation, how glorious my God are you. Praise, O God.